She's bald! Bald, bald! You fixed me up with a bald woman!
Hey everyone, welcome to another behind the scenes video for true figure design process aficionados. First, let me explain what you're watching and what I'm doing. I'm smack in the middle of finishing sculpt of my upcoming character, more precisely hair. But this is not the sole reason for this video. I will also show my usual path from digital to physical figure and share some tips along the way. Maybe it will help you to understand some decisions behind the design process. After I finished blocking initial idea and adding small polishing touches, I will check overall dimensions. 1/6 scale for character should be around 28 centimeters high. So I'm checking how 3D printable is that hair at that scale. Worst thing that can happen after hours of modeling intricate details is that final design is not printable at all. Before I continue, I will also block out some colors. This part of the process is helpful to determine what are the most obvious features. And I'll choose complementary orange and green shades with some black details around the eyes. To further solidify personality traits of the character, I want them to be quite obvious, like that protruding tongue and cheekiness in a smile. Oh boy, here comes more terrifying part of the video. First, I'll start with a box and live boolean to check cross-section of the hair. In order to attach hair to the head, I will need to create something to tie all that hair clumps into a solid form. I will create two platforms, one for each group. Those will not just keep hair strands together, but also be used to cut up keyholes on the head. Apart from being main connection points to the head, it will also provide necessary rigidity to the hair. Very thin 3D printed parts are not known for their dimensional stability. On the other hand, I do not want very thick parts either. That will introduce another set of problems. This should be precise, invisible, and above all, functional. I am following main shape of the hair that will be detachable, resulting in precise, well-defined edges. It's easy to forget how small and fragile this part is. That is why I'm checking actual dimensions with a ruler occasionally, just like I showed earlier. Since it is so thin, I will add cylindrical key on each side. This will have two purposes. First, very obvious, keying part in place. Second is for painting. There is nothing worse than struggling to hold piece you paint. So this will be also nice holding point. Only thing left is to split and create a left and right part. This is something I'll do later on. If God intended for me to use external program for preparing model for 3D printing, he surely wouldn't tell me about ZBrush. Joking aside, I'm aiming for about 3 to 4 millimeters wall thickness. This is somewhat nice middle ground for dimensional stability of the model. But even more important step is to remove fully enclosed areas that would keep uncured resin and create suction forces during printing. I'm again using live booleans to see where are those, making sure I'm moving only internal parts. That is why I've masked outside of the model. A bit tedious process, but necessary. Quick note. I've temporarily merged wheels on rollers so I can manipulate them easier. Let's see next step. 1-2-1-2 reality check test. Having so much details comes at a price. No need to panic. It is what it is. Just need to catch most of the overhanging elements on the hair without ruining all the details. Thankfully, this is on the back of the head, so it won't be that visible. I'm intentionally using supports without contact spheres because I do not want to send thin hair parts. However, I'll use contact spheres on the front of the face to prevent surface damage. Chitubox is having a fit. I just barely managed to create such a small support for teeth. Once I'm sure everything is okay after conducting test printing, I'll send certain parts to be printed on a professional 32 micron DLP 3D printer. Larger parts that are unable to fit on DLP will be printed on Mars 4 Ultra. Few days later, and here we are, in the workshop. All parts are finally here. Not because I waited DLP parts, but because Mars 4 Ultra decided to randomly turn it off and on during printing. But enough about that. DLP parts are just stunning. Fantastic initial fit and details. What is the word I'm looking for? Ah, yes, expensive. This is also a great opportunity to say thanks to all my Patreon supporters and people buying my models. You guys are making this possible. Such a clean and crisp details, precise fit, they are almost flawless. Next to them, LCD 3D printed parts look like I've carved them out of the wood in prison. All joking aside, hobby 3D printers also produce astonishing results, especially for the money they cost. Here are some close-up details shot. I am particularly proud of how I've created a transition from smaller to bigger weaving and very satisfied with the level of details. I have to check entire figure, please bear with me. Still find hard to grasp, I'm able to go from digital to 3D printed physical model so easily. Just 10 years ago, this would cost arm and a leg. Too bad we don't see such improvements for more traditional stuff like model preparation. Since we are on topic, to prevent breathing in airborne particles, I'm always wet sanding. Of course, I'm not going to show entire boring process of sanding, but here is something to watch out. Even though I'm using contact spheres, if not removed carefully, you can end up with a small surface marks like I did. Soaking supports in warm water can alleviate this. However, I'm always removing them before cleaning, as I'm unable to fit entire modular supports in ultrasonic cleaner. I'll have to deal with those later. For now, I am focusing my attention to fit two main parts. As a creator, I feel gratification when everything fits. I know, you're probably, okay, we get it, it fits, do something else. Okay, how about some priming and sanding? I filled all those holes with Mr. Hobby 500 primer. Also sprayed some 1200 over the entire figure. For large support spheres, I used coarser grit sandpaper and coarser grit induced sun sanding marks. It is gift that keeps on giving. Anyhow, after a few iterations of sanding and priming, here's how it looks finished. I hope you guys enjoyed this journey from digital to physical 3D model. I've decided to make a complete series out of this one, and there will be a great deal of how-tos in upcoming weeks. So keep on watching. Until next time, thanks for watching. Ciao, ciao.